there were some early conceptual ideas editorially. I shot the movie to be very unconventional cutting patterns.
What he was doing was really, really smart, because when you're approaching a movie that's as massive as this was, in terms of just the amount of material they had to get, and but for the budget, and we, Gary and I never talked about this, but one of the things that he did was to shoot it in a way that you can be very efficient in with the actors, with their performances.
Nice. And let's cut. Check.
And what that does is it means you're less likely to need to go back and do really costly reshoots. You're less likely to have to go back and get certain things over because you didn't quite get it perfect the first time.
I remember being a first-time director, but I don't actually know how anybody does this the first time who hasn't been in an editing room, because when I'm shooting, I'm in the editing room in my head. I mean, I may be in the middle of the woods, I may be hiking up there, and there may be a sense of spontaneity, I may be playing with it, but all the time I'm sitting at the Avid cutting what I'm doing in my brain while I'm shooting. It's the only way to do a scene.
We had our editors on set with us throughout, cutting together sequences as they'd come in. And of course, sometimes you get half of a sequence 1 week, and then you don't shoot the other half for another 2 weeks or whatever that is.
You know what coverage you need, you know what angles you need, but more than that, you're feeling your way through the scene and you're imagining what you're gonna do editorially. Now, that all changes when you get in the editing room, but it gives you a sense of focus and purpose.
During production, you see sequences and you see, wow, that's really working, that's really cool. Gary, as the director, might have thoughts because of those sequences moving forward.
It is a continuum when you do that. You're always thinking, not just about editorial options. Anybody can do that. That's how much coverage do you shoot. But really, what's my vibe through the scene? And stylistically, what does this scene mean? And how does it feel? What am I trying to evoke with my shot selection? What's my way through? I'll give you an example. I designed the launch room with that little vestibule where the tube is, knowing that I was going to one day shoot a reverse master at a critical moment in the scene to reveal the tube. I literally drew the room and discussed with Phil that I needed this set in a vestibule so I could get to that reverse master. That's editorial driving production design, and then driving the shot design, and then ultimately being the way we cut the scene. If you haven't cut a movie, it's very hard to understand that that editorial choice is even driving production design, which is happening in the prep. It really is very much a continuum.
This is a pretty linear story in the book and in the script. So there's not a lot of shuffling that needs to happen structurally, because the structure we knew worked from the script, and the way Gary shot it, we knew the structure was pretty solid, which I guess sometimes doesn't happen. Thankfully, we've never had to deal with that.
The book is so vivid that you have to come at it in a slightly different way than what you're normally used to.
And the editing style in this case was really a continuation of that independent handheld camera style. The choices of Stephen Marioni and Juliet Welfling are just great editors who carried that vision along through post perfectly.
Stephen and Juliet are very bold, unconventional, different kinds of editors, and they don't cut in typical Hollywood cutting patterns. And there are probably 300 jump cuts in the movie that you don't even realize. I don't think there's anybody that just puts two pieces of film together as brilliantly as Juliet Welfling does, in the way that she's able to kind of orchestrate these jump cuts in ways that are imperceptible to the human eye.
Almost another type of handheld editing style, where the jump cuts are almost seamless at times, but it felt very human, very natural.
So a lot of the conceptualization of how we would cut the film was actually in the prep, and in the way we shot it, and in the way we went into that editorial process before we ever began.
You'd freeze to death first.
No, because I didn't light a fire.
Well, that's a good way to get killed.
What's a good way to get killed?
It was in a form that kept you in that first-person narrative, where you're in the shoes of the protagonist always.
And I was very specific with Juliet about what I wanted and the way I wanted this to feel subjective. So that was one thing. But then Stephen Marioni is, I think, peerless in shaping a narrative, understanding performance, understanding the pace of a film. And with Stephen, I got to find almost this final rewrite, and we restructured a lot of stuff, Stephen and I did.
We spent a lot of time, Gary was really, really careful, and I assume this is not secret information, he's very neurotic about it. He'll tell people that, compulsively so.
It's not bad, but it's not better.
He would know, like, if we got to the end of the reel and there was some story point that wasn't quite hitting the way it needed to hit, he'd know it. Like, instinctually, he'd just know it. And he'd keep kind of pointing me to try to help us zero in on what that thing was.
I think that's better.
Sometimes one shot can convey so much visual information that it affects 1,000 things behind it.
And one of those moments was this section with the training center. And once they got to the Capitol and they start training, and there was this nagging thing that was really bugging Gary, that it started to feel like a spa. Like, it started to feel like they're in the Capitol and they're learning how to fight, and isn't this great? And it's like they're training for the Olympics or something. And the tension of that, the reality that they're training to kill each other in a game, in this sick game, kind of started to subside a little bit. And we finally got to a point where we were ending that scene with the tree and seeing that Rue was looking. And Gary said, I don't like the fact that we're cutting from Rue to Haymitch looking at a kid at a birthday party. It feels very arbitrary. Like, there's no organic thing to join those two things together.
That gave me the idea, okay, let's just turn this cafe that we've shot as a cafe into a gambling emporium. And then I CG'd some gambling booths in the side and put people betting and things like that. And it changed the nature of what that whole thing was.
What if we cut to it? Because we knew that we were missing a little bit of the game element of this. So what if there's an odds board? What if we cut from Rue in there to a close-up of Rue on an odds board?
And I brought in my old storyboard artist, Len Morganti, for that. And I remember bringing him in and having him draw that odds board. And then, you know, having done an animated movie, I just basically did it like an animatic. I scanned that and then dropped it into the cut. And when I saw it, I knew instantly we were able to establish Rue. We were able to establish the cold nature of the Capitol and sort of the objectification of these kids. So much happened in a single image.
I do think now maybe we could leave a little more Rue, right? Yeah.
This is going to be great, Steve.
Yeah, no, this is a huge fix.
Huge. Inestimable.
Right.
It's a bigger deal than
it's going to continue to have impact on every scene.
And all these things which are about, you know, orienting to the game, getting ready for it, everybody feeling tense, all of this plays completely.
Yeah,
the Woody stuff plays differently. Woody deciding to be sober plays differently. When he tells her, you know, tomorrow, you know, they're going to evaluate you, all this stuff plays different. And even when he says, the train alone plays different because she's special.
Yeah.
She has higher odds, you know. Awesome. Suddenly it changed the meaning of the scene and everything after it. There's something so bent and twisted about people gambling on these kids' lives that it affected that character transition, which was so pivotal in the movie.
There's a sickness and a bigger context that gave all of this.
You know, it probably would never have occurred to me while I was, like, either writing the script or even shooting.
That was definitely, I know for Gary and for me too, it was one of those kind of moments that you're like, oh wow, that's the power that editing kind of has. That's the power where you can really change a story and change an audience's relationship with a story with just adding two or three shots.
Here we are at Air Studios, a beautiful converted church in London where we're recording our, in fact, this is my cup of English tea, where we're recording our score with James Newton Howard and a bunch of very, very talented English musicians. It's been fantastic so far. It's Christmas time. It's dark at 3 o'clock. But it's a wonderful English winter. We're having a good time. We're almost finished. It's been kind of glorious. Behind me you can see this massive pipe organ. So I think they bought this place for its acoustics. It was originally built by George Martin, the Beatles producers. So a lot of hallowed history here. Anyway, it's fun to be almost near the finish line, and the score sounds absolutely amazing. James has done a great job. So I'm going to go rest now, because I've been doing this for a year and a half. Okay, ta-ta, bye.
James was somebody Gary loved from a long time ago. He's known him for a long time. I love James. Everybody loves James's music.
James was actually a relationship that went back longer than anybody for me. I met James on the scoring stage of Dave. We were together in the mix all the time. I mean, you know, we were both kids at the time, and so we've known each other for a very, very long time. I respect him enormously. I mean, I think Dave is one of the best scorers to any one of my movies. He's somebody I've always wanted to work with, but just he's tremendously busy doing a lot of stuff, and it's not always possible. But he did a ridiculously good job, especially in the time he had. It was just a wonderful collaboration, and I thought his work was just remarkable. And you know, I can't wait to do another movie with him. I love James. You know, I can't say enough. It was great.
We all loved it. Beautiful.
And then when you enter the Capitol, T-Bone brought in Arcade Fire brilliantly for the tribute parade anthem.
He knew who to bring in, and he knew how to work with them in a way that absolutely evoked the feeling that we needed. You know, that Arcade Fire anthem, that Capitol anthem, this kind of weird, buoyant, but fascistic anthem is just, I mean, it's impossible to imagine a better version than that.
So James got a hold of that, and they talked and decided, okay, James would write like a 2.5 minute version of it. And we had, you know, all these choirs in England singing it. It's just the most chilling thing on the planet. And it really worked. I mean, it was T-Bone, Arcade Fire, and James really shaped that entire section of the movie. And it's so chilling and big and triumphant and all at the same time.
You know, people don't really understand how important sound design is in a movie, especially in a movie like this. It's not dialogue driven. I mean, it creates a sense of pace and tone and modulation. I've never seen sound mixers this good. They were remarkable, these guys, and what they did.
The early conversations that I had with Gary regarding the sound from the film started with a lot of research on my part. I went through the book and I took all the references that Susan Collins had made. And then I took the script that Gary had worked on, the first draft of the script, and I went through the entire script and made notes about things that would be brought up visually that might make sounds, or things that were referencing sounds, particularly story points that had reference to sound, and things that were related to Katniss's character and how she perceived the world and how she would understand the world both visually and sonically.
One thing about this movie and sound is that in the book, it's written first person. So throughout the book, you're hearing Katniss talk to herself. You're hearing her thoughts. It's able, and it helps to put things together because you never cut back to the Capitol. You never cut anywhere else. It's all her putting the pieces together in her head.
The sound design has to have, you know, the smallest details of just one person walking around this pristine forest, and just any little cricket and hint of water or leaves or whatever it is, she's tuned in to every sound because she's hunting or being hunted.
You don't really realize how much sound focuses you into the narrative, how much it establishes a sense of place and creates a sense of reality, how much it can, like, even help a dialogue scene in terms of what you play ambiently around it, how much it focuses you around the screen, and how much it establishes mood.
What are you gonna do with the 100-pound deer, Catnip? It's reaping day. The place is crawling with peacekeepers.
I was gonna sell it.
Really great. Yeah. I mean, I just came in the middle, but
yeah,
I love
check it out.
Yeah, check it out.
Hi, guys.
So her awareness of sound is incredibly important, and the world that Lon had to create around her to do that, to intensify her fear, her this survival, and that world was incredibly intimate and had to be really powerful.
What are you gonna do with that when you kill it?
It's just perfect.
Damn you, Gale. It's not funny.
It's what are you gonna do with it?
And I gotta say, the cue's magnificent, but the world, the
you smell
sound
it.
Effects
you
are
smell
so
it.
Fantastic. Yeah. Like where that loon comes in, the bow creaks, the feet, it's just great.
I've changed my view over time on things like, you know, both of my shooting style and in sound design. You know, I wanted the forest to envelop you. I wanted it to be a whole rich world. There's times we played the surrounds, but like, there's times I love in a movie where the spaceship flies by you and they pan it across the theater and you feel it like flying overhead. But in this movie, which needs to feel so naturalistic, I can never call your attention to the filmmaking, which sometimes is a bummer because you want to be groovy sometimes and go, you know, isn't this cool what I'm able to do? But that's not this movie. This movie is pure naturalism.
Because the movie is not really about action scenes. The movie is about this person's experience and PETA's experience and the different kids going through this.
Sometimes restraint, like we don't play just for us. The best example of that is when we completely pull the room tone when the tube shuts. Nobody could kind of believe I wanted to do it, but I said, well, what if we just have nothing? Like, I mean, you don't realize how much sound you're hearing when you think you're hearing nothing. There's room tone, there's ambient sound, there's air. But when you just make the track dead, it's a very jarring thing to the audience. So Lon and I also talked a lot about how to use silence, how to use rest, how to be spare. Another example is the cornucopia melee where there's no sound effect at all.
Not having sound at the beginning of the games was an important decision that didn't come lightly. The beginning of the game is such a visceral experience, and it's so violent in its concept that the goal was not to play that up in any way other than in sort of the way your heartbeat would be if your heart, your pulse starts racing.
The phrase I always had on the set is, this feels too much like a movie. You know, I don't want this to feel like a movie. That feels like a movie. That looks like a movie. In fact, they like made little plaques for me, like, it's too much like a movie, or they would make fun of me for saying that. But that was kind of my mantra. Like, I don't want this to feel like a movie. I want this to feel like you're glimpsing and you're voyeuristic on the experience. And that's true for the sound design as well.
And I thought possibly once she's out in the open, you'd start to hear nature. You'd start to hear, you know, when they're running, you might start to hear screams, like really distant. But I always thought that when I was putting it together, that it would be very stylized, very abstract, and that it would be very far off, that it's out of focus, that the sound is out of focus in the same way that you can do the, you know, the same thing with picture.
And when we put those sounds in, it sort of took you one step to paying too close attention to the violence, instead of paying attention to the experience that Katniss was going through, and just the absolute sort of dysfunction of where she was and her not knowing where she was. And that moment is personified when she runs into Foxface. We cut away from all the mayhem on the field and we go into the forest and she runs and slams into Foxface and it's super loud and back to reality and you hear feet and you hear them hit each other and all we hear is their breathing and it's very intimate between them. And then they go away again and we go back to no sound. And those kinds of changes point up sort of the element of being inside the heads of the kids as they're going through this experience and not it becoming a broad action type of a scene.
We don't play the sound effects because I don't want to pull you into the screen. I want you to see that moment with a certain amount of detachment, almost like Katniss sees it through a haze remotely. the way an auto accident happens, but you almost feel apart from it. And a lot of those things are created through sound design that need to be very, very specific. And so, yeah, we did some kind of gutsy stuff that way, I think. You know, not using sound effects there, playing a lot of silences, being very, very subjective in the sound design, what she hears, what she doesn't hear, how things fall away, how things come back.
I think we mixed the movie 3.5-4 weeks, which is a little longer than most, but I think it was really important because they built such good sound. And we luckily had the time to do it, and we're really happy. But Lon did an amazing job.
Well, there are so many phases to this, and with each one, the movie has to get better. It's got to get better when you adapt the book to a screenplay. It's got to get better as you're casting and doing your design work and pre-production. It's got to continue to grow, obviously, and get better and realize all its potential and more when you're shooting. And when you finish the shoot and come back home, and we came back to LA, we had 1,000,000+ feet of film. We had great raw material, but now it still had to evolve and grow and change and get better in this next phase.
And by the way, I think ultimately we made a very, very efficient version of the movie, and I don't think more time would have made it any more efficient. But for Gary, a commitment to what has been, particularly on the tail end, relentlessly difficult hours in post-production, to make sure that we could make the date, but making sure that everybody knew that keeping on track for that date meant so, so much to our movie and meant so much to establishing a beachhead and hopefully getting these books off to the start that they deserve.